Okay. Now, the topic for this morning, if those of you who are just visiting, I don't know if we have anybody here who's new, but we've been going through the story, starting in Genesis, and we're painting, like looking at the Bible's big picture. And the topic for this morning, we're up to Hour of Darkness, referring to Jesus' death by crucifixion and the events leading up to it. Now, I want to sketch for you this morning what took place in those days in early April, A.D. 30. Now, some would put it at A.D. 33. Those are really the 2 years that people argue about. But either way, we're in early April. I'm going with A.D. 30. And I've been helped in this particular lesson by a recent book by Andreas Kostenberger and Justin Taylor called The Final Days of Jesus. Now, Jesus' public ministry following his baptism by John, you remember that he's baptized by John, he embarks on his public ministry, but that lasted only a few years. And sometimes that surprises people. But his public ministry was just a few years, and his crucifixion, that was simply a murder under the guise of law. But as evil as it was in God's wisdom a central aspect of Christ's ministry, the work he had come to perform. Jesus came into this world as God's Messiah, as the ultimate servant of God who would usher in God's kingdom, God's final solution for the healing of this sin-sick, broken, and fragmented creation. Jesus is the center of the Godhead's rescue effort, the great reconciliation project, because he took on himself the penalty that all human sin deserved. This allows God to forgive sinners without trivializing sin, without winking at sin, without pretending that sin is no big deal. It allows him to forgive in a way that is consistent with his nature, in a way that expresses both his love and his holiness and righteousness. So it is a means of forgiving that fits all aspects of his character. And so this is what Christ has done. Christ's sacrifice is therefore the key to healing all the consequences of sin, even the damage that sin caused to non-human creation. Christ is the key to healing it all. So Paul says in Colossians 1, 19 and 20, he speaks of Jesus as the one who through whom God the Father reconciled all things to himself, making peace by the blood of his cross. Paul says in Ephesians 1, 9 and 10 that the mystery of God's will for the administration, the outworking of the fullness of the times, is to bring all things together in Christ, things in the heavens and things on the earth. And that's why Paul says in 2 Corinthians 1:20, for all the promises of God find their yes in Jesus. So he is the center of this rescue project. So whereas Jesus was murdered, he was killed at the hands of lawless men. God in his foresight incorporated that work of evil into his plan to redeem creation. It's like, you know, you're playing chess with the guy who's got it all. You see, so he sees this and says, okay, I will incorporate the evil of this and I will turn it and use it as part of the plan to redeem creation. You see that perhaps most clearly in Acts chapter 2, verse 23. That notion that this is a work of evil, and yet it's something that God had incorporated. Evil men, they didn't overpower Jesus to take his life. Right? How could that happen? They did not overpower Jesus to take his life. He laid his life down. He submitted to their brutality that God's wrath might be justly or righteously averted. So I say all of that as preface. What I want to talk about this morning, I want to sketch the events of the Passion Week, where Christ, from the crucifixion back to the week prior, and I want to just sketch those events, but I wanted to give you that preface so you see the crucifixion in the context of, yes, it is an act of evil and a crime and an act of lawless men, but it is also something that God foresaw and used in his plan to redeem creation. Now we see in John chapter 11 that after Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead in Bethany, which is only a couple of miles from Jerusalem, we see in John 11 that after that miracle, the Jewish leaders, they planned to put Jesus to death. And Jesus then withdrew with his disciples to a town called Ephraim, which was near the wilderness. Not sure where Ephraim is located. There are a number of ideas about it. But he does this miracle in Bethany. The Jews commit even further. They're going to kill him. He and his disciples withdraw to the town called Ephraim. And as time grew near for the annual Feast of Passover, which, as you know, that Feast of Passover also marked the beginning of the week-long Feast of Unleavened Bread. So as the time draws near for the annual Feast of Passover, Jesus comes, and you have people from all, Jews from all over the world, essentially, descending on Jerusalem. We have this annual feast Jews are to attend, Passover, and the week-long Feast of Unleavened Bread. So what happens? We have Jews flocking to Jerusalem. So the city, the population of the city simply swells. It grows tremendously. And many of the people who are coming, many of these pilgrims, they would come a week early. And they would do that to allow time for any ritual purification that may have been necessary so that they could be sure that they could be ritually pure and thus be able to participate in the feasts. So many of them would come a week early. So they're flocking to Jerusalem and they're talking about Christ. He was abuzz. People are talking about him. They're wondering, is he going to come to the feast? Is he going to attend? There was excitement. There was tension. There was wonder in the air. This was like a time of, is he coming? Are we here in the midst of one of the great events of the world? And so you have this tremendous excitement there. And then Jesus, he arrived in Bethany. Jesus arrived in Bethany where he had raised Lazarus. He and his disciples go to Ephraim. He arrives in Bethany on Friday evening just as the Sabbath began. You know, the Jewish days begin at sundown. So he comes just as the Sabbath begins, Friday evening, and he attended a dinner that was held in his honor. He attended that dinner with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. This is where Mary anoints Jesus' feet with ointment, this very expensive ointment, and Judas is all over about it. And Jesus says, you don't worry about that. You see, she's done a great thing for me. But it's during that dinner that happened. And then the next evening, after the Sabbath goes from sundown Friday, all day Saturday, and then sundown the next day starts. Okay, so it encompasses all of the day of Saturday. So after we have Saturday evening, the next evening after the Sabbath had ended, you have a crowd of Jews from Jerusalem who come to Bethany to see Jesus and Lazarus. So remember, you've got all these pilgrims in this city. So they then come out after the Sabbath is over, and they come to Bethany. It's only 2 miles away, and they want to see Jesus, and they also want to see Lazarus. Because they're now hearing about this miracle that he has performed. They're pilgrims, and what? Out they come, they want to see all of this. Well, of course, the Pharisees and the Jewish rulers, they're seeing all this. They're saying, this guy is creating quite a stir. So they decide, then we're going to have to take Lazarus out as well. Okay, because he is a source of great interest. So they decide then that they're going to have to kill Lazarus. But this is from Friday sundown now through Saturday night, okay? And so then we get to Sunday during the day. All right, so the Passover ended at sundown. We go through Saturday night. The people have come there. Sunday during the day, the following day, the daylight hours of Sunday, Jesus then enters the city of Jerusalem. And he enters Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, riding on a young male donkey that had never before been ridden, and being accompanied by a full-grown, a mature donkey, presumably the young donkey's mother. But Jesus enters Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, riding on this young male donkey that had never been ridden, and this is a deliberate fulfillment of Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, that Israel's future king would come riding on a young donkey. So here you have this deliberate fulfillment of this prophecy, and the crowds get the symbolism. They understand what is taking place and what this means. They understand it. They're throwing palm branches in front of him, a kind of makeshift royal red carpet. Here they're throwing these things and they're hailing him, Son of David. Son of David, the Davidic king. Here he is. He's the one, the descendant of David we've been waiting for, who's going to sit. And they're throwing these palm branches as he comes riding on this donkey in fulfillment of Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Now this is where the Pharisees, what do? They tell Jesus to rebuke the crowds for their dangerous and, in their view, inappropriate words. They're thinking, you hear what they're saying to you? They're saying this to you. You need to tell them to be quiet. And in addition, this kind of talk is dangerous because it will bring the Romans down on us when they hear talk of this Davidic king. And so they tell him to silence the crowds. You hear what they're saying. But Jesus, instead of silencing them, he quotes Psalm chapter 8, verse 2 from the Septuagint translation, the Greek translation. And he quotes that which refers to children praising God himself. So they're telling him, listen, do you hear what they're saying about you? You need to keep quiet. He quotes Psalm 8, 2. You see, from the lips of children you've ordained praise. And then he tells them, now you can see that in Matthew 21, 16. But he tells them, he says, listen, if they were quiet, if they weren't crying out, Hosanna to the Son of David, here comes the Son of David, the Messiah, if they were silent, the stones would cry out. It's this momentous. What is happening in the history of creation is this tremendous, that if they didn't say it, the rocks would say, oh, rocks can't talk. As I've said before, if God wants a donkey to sing opera, it will. And if he wants those rocks to cry out, they would. And so you see, so he tells them that. They're telling him, silence them. Don't you see how inappropriate this is, how dangerous this is? He gives them Psalm 8:2, and he tells them if they are quiet, the stones themselves would cry out. And then Jesus, as he approaches, he weeps over Jerusalem, weeps over the city, knowing their rejection of him. So he comes in, he says, oh, if only you had known. If you would come to me, I long to gather you. But he knows. He knows what's in store. And in response to a request by some Greeks who had journeyed to Jerusalem for the feast, Jesus predicts his death. And he predicts his death by crucifixion. He made clear that was the purpose for which he'd come into the world. And he hinted that this would be the means of Satan's ultimate defeat. So in response, these Greeks want to see him. And he responds and says these things and indicates these things. And then Jesus, here on that Sunday, he goes and he visits the temple. He goes to the temple. You know, the temple is a complex, right? I mean, there you've got the building and you have these courtyards. It's a very large complex. He goes and he checks it all out and goes through it, sees all that's going on, all that's happening there in the temple, well, sees what's current, what's exactly happening right now. And then it's already late in the day. He then returns with his disciples to Bethany. That's where Jesus, he then goes back. So then we have Monday during the day. Okay, so this is if AD 30 is the right year, which most scholars would say, then we're looking at April 3rd. Now, as Jesus and his disciples, as they return to Jerusalem on Monday morning, Jesus curses a fig tree. He curses a fig tree that did not have on it the edible buds that appeared prior to fig season. It's a little statement he says here that, you know, wasn't fig season. Well, that's an indicator that it was time for the buds that appeared prior to fig season. They weren't great, but they were at least marginally edible. So Jesus goes and he finds no such buds there. And he curses the tree, but he does that, you see, as a kind of acted out parable of judgment on Israel. You see, that's what's behind the cursing of the fig tree. He knows what's coming up. And he does this as a kind of acted out parable of judgment on Israel for its refusal to give him what he had a right to expect. As the fig tree did not have what he went to get. And he curses it. Now you see, the fig tree is often used as a symbol of Israel in the Old Testament. It's not coincidental, it's a fig tree. And so he curses the fig tree as kind of an acted out parable of the judgment on Israel. And then inside the city, Jesus goes straight for the temple. Why? This is the happening. This is where everybody's gathered. This is where stuff's going on. Jesus goes straight for the temple, knowing full well from his prior visit the night before, the afternoon before, what's going on there. He goes straight for the temple, and he's consumed with a holy zeal and a righteous indignation. There is no wrongdoing in his overturning the tables. He's not losing his mind. He's not being sinfully angry. He was never sinful. He is acting in holy righteousness, righteous indignation over what they have done to the temple. He comes in and overturns the tables of the money changers. You think about this. This place is packed. And he comes in and you talk about courage. And he's just consumed with zeal for God and he overturns the tables of the money changers. What are these money changers? Well, you had to pay the temple tax with a Tyrian shekel. And so people would come with their currency, as when you're going to a different country, and you exchange it. Well, they were happy to exchange their currency for the Tyrian shekel needed to pay the temple tax for a fee. I'm happy to exchange your money. And you also had people who were selling the sacrificial animals in the court of the Gentiles because, hey, we got good stuff here. You want to make a sacrifice? Look, our stuff's checked out, AA rated. It's all right here for a fee. You see, so this is what's going on and what they're doing. They're turning this. Jesus is, you know, he overturns the tables. He drives the people out. And they're doing all this. And this is a stunning rebuke. You have to understand this. What a rebuke this is of the Jewish religious leaders who had accepted this corruption of worship into a means of financial gain. They turned this place into Disney World. Everybody's in here making bucks. No doubt at the expense of poor people. And so Jesus winds up, so they are robbers in a couple of senses. A den of thieves here as they think that the temple is their protection because God is always with them, as in Jeremiah. But here they're doing this and acting this way. And that only further, when Jesus does this, that only further seals his death sentence. And when evening comes, Jesus and his disciples, they again leave the city. They're not staying in Jerusalem. They're staying just outside Jerusalem. So they again, they leave the city. Then we get to Tuesday during the day and the evening. Now on Tuesday morning, Jesus returns to the temple. He returns to the temple where the crowds are gathered now. They're just excited. They want to hear, what's this man got to say? What's he doing? Did you see what he was doing in the temple? Did you see what he did? Man. So they're there. They're gathered. They want to hear. What is it with him? Is he? Is he the one? And so they gather to hear him. And the chief priests and the scribes and the elders, they immediately confront him. They shoot right to him, demanding to know by what authority he had done what he'd done the day before in the temple. Overturning the tables, driving people out, not allowing them to do this stuff. They wanted to know the authority he had for doing that. You see, they had authority over the temple and its activities. That was their jurisdiction. Who in the world is he? How dare he come into their jurisdiction and act like he's the one who makes the rules for the temple? What in the world? So they demand, they say, listen, by what authority are you doing these things? And that's when Jesus tells them, he says, all right, I'll answer your question if you answer mine. That fair enough? John's baptism, was it from heaven or from man? You answer that, and I'll answer yours. Well, you know what happens? They go over and say, oh, we can't say either way. Because if we say it's from heaven, he's going to say, well, why didn't you believe him? Because what did he say? We're gathered in anticipation of the Messiah. Why didn't you believe him? But if we say it's of man, all the people hold John to be a prophet. So they'll go crazy. So they say, we're not going to tell you. He said, all right, then I'm not going to answer your question. That's why I love these exchanges. I love them when they try to get over on Jesus. You see? He says, okay, all right, well, then I'm not going to answer yours. And that's how he handles so many of these things, you see. And he stayed on the offensive, telling a series of parables. The parable of two sons. He condemns the religious authorities for not accepting John's message. In the parable of the tenants, they're represented as disobedient, thieving, and murdering tenants. And in the parable of the wedding feast, they're those who reject God's invitation to the messianic banquet. So he's not intimidated. He's staying on the offensive teaching these parables. And there's more back and forth where they try to trap him in various ways, you know. Is it right to pay the temple tax and all these, you know, pay taxes to Rome and all of this kind of thing? And he parries all of their attempts as they try to, you know, they send their best guys in. You go ahead. You try to get him. You try to get him. Every one of them. He parries all of their attempts and he challenges their assumption about the Messiah by asking how he could be both David's son and David's Lord. He says, doesn't that tell you that maybe you're missing something about the Messiah? Maybe you've understood the Messiah in a wrong way. So the crowds are loving it. You see, they're absolutely loving this. And then Jesus launches into this lengthy, scathing criticism of the scribes and Pharisees. I mean, this is a 10 on the rebuke scale. He simply smokes them for the kind of religion that they practiced and all of that kind of thing. And then that left no doubt that he wasn't going to ally himself with Jewish leadership. When he smoked them like that, it became clear that no, he's not looking for a seat on their assembly. He's not a politician in here trying to lobby to get some kind of plugged-in power with them. No, he's coming with a different structure. You see, he's coming with something completely different. His aim was to overthrow their authority and replace it with his own. And that became clear in this confrontation and this teaching. And as they're leaving the temple at the end of the day on Tuesday, this is when the disciples are marveling at the structure of the temple, how magnificent it was. You remember Herod had built it for over a long time, and it had become this really large, marvelous complex. And this is when Jesus tells them that not one stone will be left upon another. And as they continue out of the city of Jerusalem, they stop on the Mount of Olives, just outside the city. They stop on the Mount of Olives where Jesus speaks to them about the future in response to their question about his comments regarding the temple. And this is where they conflate these things with the temple and the end time. And then Jesus, in this lengthy discourse, talks about those things. That's called the Olivet Discourse. And it's the Olivet Discourse because it was given on the Mount of Olives as they're leaving the city of Jerusalem on this day. And then we have here, we get to Wednesday. On Wednesday morning, Jesus returns to teach the people waiting in the temple to hear him. You can see what's going on now. People more and more. They're eager to hear from him. What does he have to say? Who is he? What's he doing? What is going to come of this? What is going to be the end of this? Is this the dawning? Are we going to see him wind up and get a tremendous military force and expel Rome from Palestine? What is happening right here? As I said, the average people, they were excited about it. They were drawn to him. But the leaders at this time, they're working overtime to kill him. This is what they're doing. They're working overtime to kill him, and they have a problem. It is because he's so magnetic, so popular. The common people are just enthralled by him, and you have this tremendous crowd in Jerusalem. They're saying, this isn't going to be easy. You see, we take him out, and there's going to be a riot. You see, that can be sparked very easily, so that wouldn't be good. So they're kind of trying to figure out, how can we wind up and kill him? And then the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders, these are representatives of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish ruling body. And so they met with the high priest Caiaphas in his home. So they come and they meet, and this is part of their strategy session. They're trying to work this out. How can we wind up pulling this off, given the circumstances that we're in? And they concluded that they would need to wait until after the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Feast of Passover, kick off for the week-long Feast of Unleavened Bread. And they said, look, we're going to have to wait till this is over, when the crowds dissipate and all the pilgrims return, because then there will be much less risk of us inciting a riot when we're back to normal life and all of these other people who could be easily agitated are gone. So they think this is their conclusion, they're going to have to wait. And then Thursday, during the day and the evening. Now Thursday, which is from Wednesday evening, Jewish reckoning, would run from Wednesday sundown to Thursday sundown, okay, encompassing all of the day, okay, all of the day of Thursday. Well, Thursday was the day of Passover preparation. This is the day of Passover preparation, the day when the Passover lamb was sacrificed. So this is on Thursday, and on the morning of that day, Jesus sends Peter and John to secure a large upper room in a house in Jerusalem to prepare the Passover meal. So it's time, that's going to be tomorrow, so go and prepare the Passover meal. And Jesus had arranged for them to make contact with a man, however he went about that, however he had made that, but he'd set it up so that they make contact with a man who would direct them to the appropriate place. And part of what they were saying to that man was, the teacher says, my time is at hand. My time is at hand. He knew. He knew what was coming. And so they go and they say that. Then Thursday evening, okay, after sundown, which in Jewish reckoning is the beginning of the next day, this is Passover. You see, this is Passover. So it would be Thursday night, and then take all of Friday day down to sundown Friday. So that evening, which is the beginning of the next day, this is the Passover meal, and this is when Jesus takes the Passover meal, shares it with the disciples. This is the famous Last Supper, which is a Passover meal that Jesus is eating on that evening, that Thursday evening, which is the beginning of the next day, which is Friday. Okay, I just give you the dates in our time, the way we look at them, okay? Now, during the supper, one of the things, many things happen here, but during the supper, Jesus washes the disciples' feet. And you remember that Peter, he comes to, now this is a very menial task. This was left for slaves and people. The teacher, or the Chinese, or the Laosher. You're not going to have somebody see who's, there's a certain altitude socially. And he's the rabbi, he's the teacher. The notion that he would be here washing your feet, that a slave would be somebody doing, it's just kind of, it was off-putting. And he comes to Peter, and Peter says, no way. I'm not letting you do this kind of menial stuff to me. You're too good for that. You're too big for that. You see, and he won't let him do it. And he at least balks at it. And that's when Jesus told him, unless he was willing to accept such service from him, that he, Peter, would have no part with him. In other words, Jesus is going to stoop even lower than washing feet. He is going to endure the shame, the ignominy of the cross, which was preserved for the lowest of criminals. That's why in Hebrews it says, you know, he went out bearing its shame. You see, it wasn't just a cruise, it wasn't just a death penalty. As I've said many times, our society has one way you kill people. Different states, okay? If you're worthy of the death penalty, you're going to get an injection, or you're going to get this or that. That's not how it worked then. You had different ways of killing people depending on who they were and what they were doing. And the lowest form of punishment, the form of punishment that was the most disgraceful for someone to endure, was crucifixion. And so Jesus is saying to Peter, listen, I have something even lower I'm going to do in service of you, and you must be willing to accept from me even that humiliating service. And if you will not accept humiliating service from me, you will have no life. Because there is no way to have life other than to receive from me the ultimate in humiliating service, my death on a cross for you. That's what's going on in this washing of the feet and Peter's balking. You see, and I think it's just powerful that he tells him, you have no part. Well, of course, you know, when Peter hears that, he says, all right, well then, hey, you know, take care of me. You know, if I'm not going to have any part with you, then you go ahead and wash me total. You see, and so that's how that goes. Now, Jesus informs the disciples of his coming betrayal by one of them. And then he institutes the Lord's Supper by transforming the symbolic meal of the Passover. You know, this is an ancient meal, right? I mean, this is going back to the days of Egypt. That they've been celebrating this symbolic meal that represented God's deliverance of his people. Jesus transforms that ancient symbolic meal into the Lord's Supper. He turns it into, he says, look, this bread represents my body. This juice represents my blood. What he's offering as an atoning sacrifice. So here at this Last Supper, this Passover meal, he transforms that ancient symbolic meal into the new symbolism of the ultimate deliverance of God through his body and his blood. And that's what you and I share, and we will share shortly here every Lord's Day as we gather. But this is what he does. And then when pressed, he identifies his betrayer as Judas by handing him a morsel that he dipped in some kind of juice. And then Judas books. He leaves the gathering after he's been identified. And after some teaching, there's more teaching, you know, Jesus is teaching here. They sing a hymn and they went out to the Mount of Olives. And they go out there and Jesus taught there on the Mount of Olives that they would abandon him when he's arrested. And this is where he predicts Peter's three-time denial. And you know the story. No, no, I'll never do. He says, I'm telling you. You're going to deny me three times. And so this is where he predicts that three-time denial. And then they went into the Garden of Gethsemane, which was located on the Mount of Olives. So he leaves. He's sharing the supper at this upper room in Jerusalem. He then goes to the Mount of Olives. He has some further teaching, and then he enters the Garden of Gethsemane, which is on the Mount of Olives. And in the garden, he continues to teach his disciples. And I just didn't have time to go through. I mean, there's tremendous stuff. But he continues to teach his disciples, and he prays to God in agony over his impending suffering. He's just in agony over this. He knows he's about to bear God's judgment for sin as a substitutionary sacrifice for the sins of the world. Nobody has ever done that. Nobody has done that. He's going to be crucified, which I'm telling you, that would be it for me. Just the physical stuff of being crucified would be it for me. But that's not all that's involved here. You see, he's in agony because he's going to be the sin bearer. He's not just being crucified. He's being crucified as atonement for all humanity's sins. And so Jesus is in agony over his impending suffering. He's in agony over it. And he said, look, if there could be another way, he wants it. Of course he does. But he understands and he says, look, but not my will, yours be done. He is in complete submission to the will of the Father in this. And as Jesus agonizes, the disciples sleep. He's just in torment of soul over what the road he is going to walk. The road he sees and he knows he's going to walk. And they're over here essentially oblivious. They're over here sleeping. And we have from Friday, this is probably late, probably after midnight, through late afternoon. Okay? So now in the wee small hours of Friday, this is our Friday, Judas, the betraying apostle, he leads an armed crowd. He leads this armed crowd that had been sent by the Sanhedrin. He leads them to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he knew or he suspected that Jesus and the disciples would be. Why? Because he was one of them. He knew where they hung out. He knew what kind of where they would be. So he leads this armed crowd there, and he presumably had convinced the authorities that they didn't have to wait until after the Feast of Unleavened Bread had ended. Remember, they had pretty much concluded, we're going to have to wait. But he had apparently been able to persuade them that, look, I can give you cover. I will take you there so you can take him covertly under the cover of darkness. You just take him, it'll be dark, nobody will see, he'll be done away with, and it'll be a fait accompli. So he has apparently convinced them of that, and then he takes them there. Here come these guards. And when Jesus is arrested, what happened? The disciples all flee. Now you have to think of that too. I mean, you're here, you're going through all this, serving, loving, giving, building, strengthening, all of this. And even after you tell them, you still have to see that when your tight crowd disperses, as he knew they would, that's still got to be something, right? That's still got to be something. Well, Jesus first is taken for an informal hearing before Annas. Annas is the former high priest. He's the father-in-law of the current high priest, Caiaphas. Perhaps he had masterminded Jesus' arrest after Judas had come and said, look, he was willing to betray him. And he questions Jesus about his teaching. You know, what are we, this. And Jesus, he recognizes that he's not interested in the content of his teaching. What he's looking for is a way to trap him. So Jesus tells him, he says, listen, my stuff's not secret. I was teaching publicly. I was teaching to everybody. You could go ask anybody if your true intent is to know what I taught. Well, he understood that he wasn't after that. He was after trying to trip him up and say something, you see. So when Jesus says that, that's when Jesus is struck for allegedly being disrespectful, which is a charge that Jesus denies, and he calls on him to prove, and he says, if I've done something wrong, you lay it out there. But I've just spoken the truth. I haven't done anything wrong. Well, Jesus was then sent bound for a trial before Caiaphas and part of the Sanhedrin. I say part, it says the whole council, but I think that means at this point, it's probably a quorum, which you would take 23 members of the Sanhedrin to be a quorum necessary for valid action. So he goes here, he's taken before Caiaphas and part of the Sanhedrin, who'd quickly gathered at Caiaphas's house here in the early morning in the wee small hours for a hurried trial. You see, they know what they're about. They know what they want to do. We got to take this guy out. We need to do it quickly. We need to do it quietly. We need to have him gone. So here they've gathered at Caiaphas's place. And Caiaphas and company, Jesus, they're saying all kinds of things about him. Jesus denies their false accusation. He just says, stays quiet. He doesn't respond to their false accusations. He just sits there until Caiaphas puts him under oath. And when Caiaphas says, you tell us, are you the Messiah, the Son of David, the Son of God? And then Jesus then says, he's the Christ, the Son of God. And with that, you see, Caiaphas now is convinced he has all he needs to spin this to Pilate as a death penalty case. Because he can portray this before Pilate as a case of insurrection and treason. Because here he is now trying to usurp your political power as King of Jews. He's the Son of David, the Messiah. He's a political threat. So now he can spin this as a death penalty case. So he says, now from their perspective, what they're upset about is they see it as blasphemy. You see, but he recognizes in that answer the potential for a death penalty charge before Pilate. And so this is what he's doing. And they all condemned him as worthy of death, and then the beatings and the mockings begin. Our Lord, the sinless one, God the Son, the God-man, perfect, flawless, loving, giving, being beaten, abused, and mocked by people like me. And this is our Lord. Now, the formal verdict could only be delivered after sunrise, which was done. No doubt, see, with the remaining members of the Sanhedrin having filtered in over the hours. So this is something that is done. And Jesus is condemned to death. And then he's sent to Pilate for the final say on and the administration of the death penalty that they desired. And this is when Judas hangs himself. But you see, the Romans kept a tight rein on the Jews' ability to administer the death penalty because they're an occupied people and they wanted to be careful that they didn't start causing trouble and going crazy. So they sat on them in terms of the death penalty. So they're going to send him to Pilate for the final say on and the actual administration of the death penalty that they have deemed him, that he deserves. This is their ruling that they've made. Now they're taking him to Pilate, so Pilate will actually administer the death penalty. And the Jews, they press Pilate to execute Jesus. And they do that by casting Jesus as a political threat. But when Pilate learns that Jesus was a Galilean, he sees an opportunity to sidestep the issue because he smells a rat. You know, Pilate is he's an old-time politician. He sees in this that there is either motivation by jealousy or something, and he's not quite comfortable with this. He certainly is not averse to killing people, okay? But he doesn't want to be played. He doesn't want to be played by the people he's ruling. So he sees a chance in this. When he says he's a Galilean, he sees a chance to sidestep the issue by sending him to Herod Antipas, who had jurisdiction over Galilee, or at least parts of Galilee. Now, Herod Antipas, this is one of Herod the Great's sons. You know, Herod the Great, who dies shortly after Jesus is born. This is one of Herod the Great's sons. This is the son who had John the Baptist beheaded. For when John told him, he said, yeah, I see you got your wife, but it's not lawful for you to have her. I don't care. It was wrong for you to take her. You have no right to marry her. And so that didn't sit well. But he had John beheaded, and he's the person that Jesus called that fox. Now, Herod Antipas and his soldiers, they treated Jesus with contempt. They mocked him. But when Jesus wouldn't perform miracles for Herod Antipas, he sent him back to Pilate. He sends him back to Pilate. Now, Pilate tries to appease the Jewish leaders by getting them to agree that punishing Jesus would be enough, and they have none of it. They're going to have none of that. You see, no, they won't go for that. They won't allow him. See, they have none of that. And then he offers to let the crowd choose whether he should release Jesus or this violent insurrectionist known as Barabbas. And he's hoping, okay, they're going to take Jesus and then I won't have to be killing. I'm happy to kill this guy. He's a convicted insurrectionist. But they stir up the crowd and get them to what? Choose? No, release Barabbas. That's what we want you to do. Well, he then goes and he has Jesus flogged, which is less severe than the scourging that precedes crucifixion. But it's still nothing you'd like to go through. He has Jesus flogged, where he's also mocked and given a crown of thorns and abused. And then he presents the flogged Jesus, hoping there when they see that, he says, here's the man. They're hoping that's going to appease them. They'll be okay, all right, we see. That's enough, that's sufficient. None of it. They cry out for him to be crucified. And he questions Jesus again, and he's concerned about this, but he finally relents, and he sentences him to be crucified. And then Jesus is then scourged by Roman soldiers. And you've seen the movie, probably, The Passion. And this is where these Roman soldiers, these strong psychopath people, take these whips that have pieces of bone and metal woven into them, and they just fillet you with this. And so this is what they do when Jesus is whipped like that. Now this, they repeated the mocking. You see, they were on a meme. They were on a theme. They were going, it's not the, that wasn't the second bell, was it? Was it? Oh, I'm sorry, I would have said something. I hate to do this to you, but okay, I see people coming in. I don't like it, but I have no choice. Thanks.